Luke chapter 13, reading verses 1 through 9, says there were present at that season some that told him of the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And Jesus answering said unto them, Suppose ye that these Galileans were sinners above all the Galileans, because they suffered such things? I tell you, nay, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Are those 18 upon whom the tower in Siloam fell? In other words, these 18 that a tower fell on them and killed them, it says, and slew them. Think ye that they were sinners above all men that dwelt in Jerusalem? In other words, do you think they were greater sinners than everybody else, and that's the reason why this happened? Nay, except you repent, ye shall all likewise perish. He spake also this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came and sought fruit thereon, and found none. Then he said unto the dresser of his vineyard, Behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this fig tree, and I find none. Cut it down. Why cumbereth it in the ground? In other words, why is it taking up this space? Why are you leaving it here? And he answering said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also, till I shall dig about it and dung it. And if it bear fruit, well. If it bear fruit, well. And if not, then after that, you shall cut it down. A week or so ago, I watched about 90 seconds of some country music award show. I don't know which one it was. I stopped on it. I don't even remember why I stopped on it. I don't even remember who was announcing the category. But the category was something like country music's duo of the year. I'm not saying that's the exact name of the award, but that's kind of what they were bringing up. Who's going to be the greatest duo of this particular year? And they began to call out names of all these country music acts, and I don't remember any of them. If I did know them, I don't remember that I knew them. But anyway, they called out one, and I don't know that I wouldn't have known this duo if it hadn't been for Facebook. You know, Facebook opens our minds up to a lot of different things. Good, bad, ugly, whatever. But anyway, I would have probably never known. I don't listen to country music. I haven't listened to it in years. But I this couple that has gained so much notoriety, become very famous, because it was in March of this year that Joey, the wife of Rory, from the group Joey and Rory, not just a group, but a married couple. It was in March of this year that she lost her battle to cancer. If I remember correctly, she was 40 years old, somewhere around that age, 40 years. Obviously, I didn't know her. I've never really listened to any of their music before, but she seemed like such a precious soul. And I went and I began to search them and find out more information about them. And I watched part of a recording that they had done with Bill Gaither. Most of y'all, or many of y'all, are familiar with the Gaithers. I love the Gaithers. Some of their specials, their homecoming specials. My, Vestal. I like the old ones with it. Anyway, let me get back to this. I was watching an album that they produced, and they had sung some of the songs called Hymns That Are Important to Us. And watching this country music star battling cancer and hearing her sing, it is well with my soul, that'll bring tears to your eyes, or at least it did mine. I'm looking at this. I'm watching this. She's gone. She's already passed. And I'm watching this on YouTube. What a testimony. And yet I still ask, why was she not healed? Her testimony is, we don't have to understand. We just have to hold His hand. The very first song on the CD is one of my favorites. Take My Hand. precious Lord. I've listened to that most of the time I've heard that. It's been with Elvis Presley. Elvis has a version of that song, and my. I'll tell you, it's an awesome song. Listen to the lyrics. Precious Lord, take my hand. Lead me on. Let me stand. I'm tired. I'm weak. I'm worn. Through the storms, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, and lead me home. Those lyrics are by Reverend Thomas Dorsey, a minister. Reverend Thomas Dorsey, and while he was in a revival service, listen to this. He's in a revival service, and he gets kind of a text message. I know this is before text messaging and all that, but that's what it would be for us. He gets a text message and looks at his phone. It was actually a telegram. He gets a telegram, and the telegram reads, "Hurry home. Your wife just died." How'd you like to get? He said, "I couldn't believe it." He said, "I didn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it was true." And I rushed home to find out that she had died in childbirth. But the baby survived. The baby survived. His wife dies, but the baby survives. And dies 2 days later. He said, "They tried to tell me things that would be soothing to me. They tried to encourage me. They tried to tell me everything is going to be all right. They tried to encourage me." But he said, "None of that soothed me back then, even unto today." He said, "It was in that moment of frustration. They were trying to encourage me." And he said, "They meant well." But he said, nothing that any man could say or do was an encouragement to me. And he said, "In that moment, I just began singing what would become, 'Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand.'" Bad things happen to good people. I know, don't get me wrong, I know that the Word of God says there's none good. Jesus said there's none good but God. But you know what I mean when I say good people. Jesus is responding to a question about these Galileans whose blood, our text says their blood was mingled with the sacrifices. They were offering, seemingly they were offering sacrifices unto God. Is that God's judgment? Why did God allow that? You know, for the most part, we understand death. When it's someone who's 100 years old, we understand death. When it's someone that we feel like has lived a good long life, what we don't understand is untimely death. When someone young passes away, when someone, it seems like they had their entire life. When it seems like their entire life was before them. In March of last year, 8 people died. Members of the Independent Haitian Assembly of God Church. They passed away, not in a nightclub, not in a bar, not in a strip club, riding a church van. Why do these things happen? Why does it happen? Seemingly, Pilate's soldiers slaughtered these Galileans. Can you imagine? Why would we think that's fair if soldiers came in here and began to kill us because we worship God? How is that fair? Let me tell you, friend, life isn't fair. There's nowhere in this book where it says life's fair. Life's not fair. Bad things happen to good people, and Jesus knows what they're thinking. He knows what's on their mind. What did they do? Why do we always want to blame people? What did you do to get this? You must have some sin in your life. Must be something wrong. You know, I don't have those problems because I'm perfect. One of the greatest difficulties I've had, friend, I feel awful today. I don't feel good, but it's not about me. But one of the questions I've asked is why? Why am I dealing with this? Why am I dealing with it? What did I do to cause it? See, to the Jewish mind, it was impossible for you to be in right standing with God and be sick. It was impossible for you to be poor and be in right standing with God. They couldn't conceive that a person could be diseased and be one of God's children. Had to be something wrong with you. What's wrong with them? Yeah, they must have some secret sin. Must have something wrong with them. The word of God is clear. Sometimes the righteous die and the wicked live. Sometimes it's the drunk driver that kills a family as he's been drinking all night, wakes up still drunk, gets in a vehicle, they're on their way to church, and they have an accident, and the one that survives is the drunk driver. Life's not fair, friend. Sometimes bad things happen to good people, but Jesus is reminding us it's not about when people die. It's about what relationship they have with God when they die. He's saying, do you think these people, verse number 4 says, do you think these 18 people who died when the tower fell on them were greater sinners than all the other men living in Jerusalem? What he's saying is if you've never repented, you will perish. He doesn't mean physically. He means eternally. The tower fell on these in Siloam. How many times has the tower almost got you? How many times has the tower almost got you? I had a buddy fell asleep. I'm thinking about deer season. I don't know that you'd really call it sleeping. That's back in my drinking days. And he was asleep. But he woke up in a tree stand, leaning forward, looking at the ground. I can't remember 20 feet. I can't remember how high he was off the ground. Gun in his lap, looking down. How'd you like to wake up like that? How'd you like to fall out of that tree and die? And then where would you wake up? How many close calls have you avoided? How many of us have had guardian angels that have had to put in a little overtime? Amen. I didn't see Joe raise his hand, but blowing yourself up with gas and fire? Kaboom. My wife almost got trampled by cattle one time. She was helping me in a corral. How many times? What's happened to you? How many close calls? A motorcycle wreck. A car wreck. Whatever. I've lost count of the number of times I've almost died. All I can say is praise the Lord for your protection. That's all I can say. And that's all you can say. But he's trying to change their mind. What if the tower had fallen on you? What if instead of a Sunday morning service, you were up here in a casket and I'm preaching your funeral? What if the tower had fallen on you? What if I say, oh, praise the Lord, they've gone to be with Jesus. They're in heaven this morning. Oh, they're rejoicing. They're walking streets of gold and fishing. And we know none of that's true. I mean, you hear that at funerals, but, you know, of course, it's not true. But it doesn't matter what I say. It doesn't matter what I say. I can't preach anyone. I mean, people say, well, they preached them right into heaven. No. Actually, they didn't. It doesn't matter if I try to preach them into hell. I could stand up and say they were the worst person on the planet and they're in hell today and you don't go there. They repented before they died. They're not going to hell. Anyway, they're trying to figure out what these people deserve. What did these people do to deserve to die? And Christ is reminding them, you all deserve to die. You deserve to die. You do not deserve to live. You don't deserve it. Paul said the wages of sin is death. Anybody here never committed a sin? Go ahead and raise your hand and we'll know you're a liar. Paul said the wages of sin. Let's read the entire verse. Romans 6:23. One of the first verses I ever memorized, I can remember. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. I like reading the whole thing. That first part, for the wages of sin is death. For the wages of sin is death. But, I like that. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's why we worship. Oh, that's why we look to the cross of Calvary. Because that's where he paid for our sins. That's where we were redeemed. It's all about Jesus. The first few verses are a warning that death comes for everyone. But the latter verses show that God is patient. One time when I was duck hunting, I used to be a duck. I used to love to call them in. I broke out my duck calls in my office the other day and made a bunch of noise and probably caused some dogs to bark. No ducks flew in the building that I saw. But one time when I was duck hunting, my first time to ever duck hunting. First time I ever went duck hunting. I didn't know anything about it. I'm out there, I got my shotgun, got my waders, and I'm in this. I was at work, and my boss came in and said, "You want to go duck hunting?" And I said, "No. Stand around in cold water waiting for birds to come in? You have lost your mind." He said, "Well, you won't have to come to work." I said, "Where are we going?" I mean, man, we took off to Stuttgart, and I was in one of them pit blinds, and a duck came in and crashed the decoys. I'm waiting for everybody. I'm like, "It's on." And I asked the guy, I said, "Why ain't anybody shooting?" I said, is it against the law to shoot ducks on the water?" He said, "It's just kind of considered unethical." That's the way I got my first duck. Anyway, later on, I hadn't lost my water shooting abilities, and I waited for like five or six, or I don't remember how many ducks to line up in a row. I got there, man. I was hit. I waited for them to line up, and I took them out. It's kind of sorry. Aren't you glad God's not like that? Aren't you glad that tower fell, but God wasn't up in heaven saying, "Oh, wait a second. Wait till those two deer. I mean, wait till those. Wait till those two. Those 12. Those. Wait till they get right lined up so I can take them out." I'm glad God's not like that. John 15, Jesus said, "I am the true vine, my Father is the husbandman, and we are the branches. Good fruit proves to us and to others who we are." He says that we need to have good fruit. Good fruit proves. I know what a tomato plant looks like. I can identify a tomato plant, but if it doesn't, even if it doesn't have any fruit, or vegetables. Potato. But regardless, it shows who we really are. I remember a story from a few years ago where a building superintendent in New York called the police on somebody. They called the police on one of their tenants because this guy was growing marijuana on top of the building. Up on top of the building where they live, the roof of the building, this guy was growing marijuana. And the New York Police Department showed up and they confiscated those illegal plants. They confiscated the wacky weed. Till somebody said, "What are you doing with all these tomato plants?" Matthew 12:33, Jesus said, "Either make the tree good and his fruit good, or make the tree corrupt and his fruit corrupt, for the tree is known by his fruit." Peach trees have peaches. If I walk up to a tree covered in pears, if I say, "Hey man, come here, I want to show you this. Check this tree out. It's covered in pears," and I say, if it's covered in pears and I tell you, look at this peach tree, you're going to think I'm a liar or an idiot. Some of y'all may think both, but we have two Persian cats. I love my fluffy, furry Persian cats. My. They are just so awesome. But if you tell me, oh, I love my Persian cat too, let me show you a picture of it, and you pull out a picture of your dachshund, I won't say you ain't right. There's something wrong with you. That ain't a per. Fruit defines us. I'm sure I'm not the only one who's ever pulled up some weeds that ended up not being weeds. Or maybe you get, anybody ever get a little overzealous with the weed eater? And it becomes a flower eater? Years ago, my aunt asked me why. She said, why didn't you pull out these weeds in the flower bed? Why didn't you pull out these weeds? I said, I thought they were flowers. I was being honest. I thought, because I learned it's a lot better to err on the side that a weed is a flower than to err on the side that a flower is a weed. I learned that lesson. What are you saying? When in doubt, leave it. When in doubt, leave it. Don't pull it up. Why are you saying this? Because verses 6 through 9 remind us God's not looking to pull you out. God's not looking to weed you out. Oh, you might be a fruit tree, but you might be producing. You might not be producing quite as much as you ought to. God's not trying to weed you out. Jesus gives a parable describing a man who has a vineyard that contains a fig tree. A fig tree that's not producing any fruit. Years ago, I planted a few fruit trees. I planted some trees, and eventually I had to cut them down. I didn't want to, friend. I didn't want to go out there and cut those. They weren't doing anything. They were dead. They weren't producing. Eventually, I had to go cut them down. But I didn't want to. What did I want them to do? I wanted them to grow. I wanted them to be alive. I wanted them to produce fruit. I didn't want to cut them down. Friend, neither does God. Neither does God. I cut the fruitless trees down because all they were doing was taking up space. That's exactly what Jesus is saying in our text. God gets to a point where he says, I'm done. God gets to a point where he says, no more. I'm finished. As a child, I thought my uncle and aunt, Odin and Nan Chandler, a lot of y'all know who I'm talking about. I thought Odin and Nan had the biggest, most awesome garden in the whole world. I remember seeing Nan's towering sunflowers, rows and rows of corn and all kinds of stuff. I actually had a garden. Odin wanted so much to make me into a gardener. He wanted me to be a gardener so bad, and I actually had a garden for like 2 years. I hear people talk about the cathartic, the soothing effects of being out in their garden. Man, I hated it. I hated that thing. I hated it. I had one of those walk behind. I mean, ginormous. I mean, one of the heaviest garden tillers ever made. One of them walk behind garden tillers, and the switch on it was broken. It was either wide open or totally stopped. I'm serious. I'm not making this up. It was either full throttle or dead stop. And that thing was so powerful. And I hadn't, you know, you're supposed to break the ground up before you till. I mean, I didn't know that. I just got a tiller. That ground was just rock solid hard. And that thing was wide open. I rode that thing like a surfboard. I mean, I was surfing in my yard on that tiller. I wore that tiller out and wore me out and wore the ground. Anyway, when my wife said, we're done, a couple years later, she said, you can get rid of that tiller. We're done. That day, that hour, I went out there and I had one of them raised up Toyotas that you'd put the blocks in. I mean, it was raised up, and I picked that garden tiller up by myself and set it in the back of that Toyota, which is probably the reason why I had back surgery about 3 years ago or so. I'm glad some people love gardening. I'm glad some people enjoy, because I like the fruits of their labor. Gardening is not for me. But contextually, this fig tree represents Israel. I mean, contextually, in this parable, the fig tree is Israel. In these verses, God is portrayed as the owner of the vineyard. Jesus is the caretaker. But the fig tree also can represent every single one of us. Every one of us can be represented by this fig tree. I love this story. I love this because we see the mercy and grace of God. We see in this story, we see in this parable, in this text, God's not out to get us. God's not out to cut you out, to remove you. God loves you. He gave Jesus Christ to die for you. He does not want to weed us out. Say, well, in this text, God's the owner and he is the one wanting to remove the fruit tree. Yeah, but think of how many years. Think of how many years he's already allowed the fig tree to stay there. But because of Jesus Christ, he allows us, he gives us more grace and more mercy. The idea is just one more chance. Little tree, he's saying, little tree, you deserve to be cut down. You deserve to be removed, but I'm giving you another chance to produce more fruit. I'm giving you a chance because of our intercessor, our mediator, Jesus Christ, the Word of God, the Word from Jesus Christ to you and us, to you and me, is just a little more time. A little more time, one more chance. He said, let me dig, let me dung. In other words, he's digging in the soil to aerate the soil, to put in fertilizer. We need to make room for God. We need to allow the Holy Spirit to dig in our life, to begin to remove things that would hinder us from growing. We need to allow the Holy Spirit to dig and dung and fertilize us with his Spirit, with the Word of God. We've got to allow us to, we could go and hang out in John 15 for an hour or two. What does he want us to do? Produce fruit. What does he do to cause us to produce fruit? He prunes us. He cuts us. He pulls us back. He tears us down. Last week, for just a millisecond, I mean just a second in time, I contemplated. I wanted to pick up the phone. I actually thought about it. Calling my cousin, Teresa Sharp. Something I wanted to tell her. I thought, wait till I tell. She's not here anymore. She's gone. This week after that happened, I went to her Facebook page. And I saw on her wall, her Facebook page is still there. I saw on her wall where I'd posted, love you, and praying. That's all I said, love you, period, praying, period. And she said, praise the Lord, need prayer more than anything right now. One of her very last posts read, it's all about the cross. In 3 months, I'd be conducting her funeral. That's the reason why I preach the way I do. It is all about the cross. It doesn't matter if you're poor, if you're rich, if it doesn't matter if your name is in the paper for the right reasons, the wrong reasons. Doesn't matter if we're in the White House or the poor. It does not matter that President Obama is up there. It doesn't matter. All that matters is my name written down. Donald Trump being elected to the White House doesn't mean that gives him a ticket to enter into the kingdom of God. All that means is we elected him. All that means he gets to go to the White House for a while. It's all about making it to heaven. It's all about seeing Jesus someday. It's all about getting there and taking our friends, our family with us. The only comfort that I have in my cousin's death is the belief that I will see her again. Ecclesiastes 9:4, one of my favorite verses, says it's better to be a live dog than a dead lion. It's better to be a live dog than a dead lion. In other words, Proverbs is saying there's only hope for the living. Once we've passed from this world, once we leave this world, once we've died, there's no hope in changing our final destination. We can't go back and undo what has been done. Let it go. Let the past go. Don't hang on to the past. Let it go. Live in the present and make sure we know where we're going when we leave this world. Matthew 21:19, Christ saw this fruitless fig tree. He saw this fig tree that didn't have any fruit on it. It wasn't, and you know what he did? He cursed it. Jesus cursed this fig tree that wasn't producing fruit and said, since you're not producing fruit, you'll never produce fruit. He cursed it. Never produce fruit again. We see that in Revelation 22. Verse 11 says, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. Let he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. Let him which is righteous, let him be righteous still. Let him who is holy be him. Let them be holy forever. That's the message. If you die in your wickedness, you're wicked forever. If you die in righteousness, you're righteous forever. Matthew 7:18 through verse 20, Jesus said, a good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit. Neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that brings not forth good fruit, in other words, what's he saying? Every tree that does not produce good fruit is cut down and cast into the fire. You don't have to be a theologian to know where that fire is at, friend. I don't even have to preach that. You know that. You know that in your spirit. Every branch, every tree that doesn't produce good fruit is cut down and put in the fire. Then Jesus said, Wherefore, by their fruits you shall know them. How do you know them? By their fruits. How do you know that a peach tree is a peach tree? Because it has peaches. That's not profound. How do you know that a Christian is a Christian? Because of the fruit of their life, the fruit of their mouth. It doesn't mean we won't occasionally produce bad fruit. Doesn't mean you're going to be perfect all the time. You already knew that because you hadn't been. What's he saying? Bad fruit shouldn't characterize our life. We could look at this from so many places, from John, from Matthew. We could look at this in 1 John. We could look at this in the book of James. A good tree produces good fruit. Occasionally we mess up, but the idea is that our lives will be characterized by good fruit. The good fruit of our life isn't what saves us. A peach tree is not a peach tree because it produces peaches, but because it is a peach tree, it does produce peaches. Ever seen some? Y'all know I've got a warped sense of humor. Y'all know that? Ever seen somebody? Examining fruit in a grocery store. I always think they look kind of silly. I mean, somewhere in the voice of Nan Chandler, I always think in my mind, you don't know what you're doing. I'm like, you don't know. Why do people do that? Because nobody likes rotten fruit. Neither does God. That's why he thumps us a little. Anybody ever been thumped? Romans 7:5 says, "For when we were in the flesh, the motions of our sin, which were by the law, did work in our members to bring forth fruit unto death." When we're in the past, our past lifestyle, our past carnal nature, the fruit that we are producing fruit. It's the question is what kind of fruit? There's only two kinds of fruit. There's the fruit of life, which produces eternal life, and the fruit of death, which leads to eternal separation from God. Nothing in this world could be more important than what we're talking about this morning. Friend, this is everything. The election is not as important as this. Who they put on the Supreme Court is not as important as this. Doesn't matter if we have the most awesome judges on the Supreme Court, if one day we stand before the ultimate judge and he says, "Depart from me." We need to be fruit inspectors. But don't be looking at others. We need to keep our eyes on our own, stay in our own lane, eat off our own plate, be fruit inspectors. Because Paul said, examine yourself. Paul said, prove to yourself that you're part of the kingdom of God. And Jesus concludes this story. And if not, cut it down. And if not, cut it down. Elvis and Johnny Cash are two of the artists I've known, that I've listened to, who've recorded this song. You may run on. It's called Run On. One of the names of it is Run On. Some say it's Run On for a Long Time. Some say the name of the song, it's got different names. It's just sooner or later, God's going to cut you down. I ever heard that song. It says you may run on. This is the lyrics. You may run on for a long time, but sooner or later God's going to cut you down. Go tell that long tongue liar. Go tell that midnight rider. Tell the rambler, the gambler, the backbiter. Oh my mama. Tell them that God's going to cut them down. What a tragic end for millions. What a tragic end for millions. I don't want that to be my song. I don't want that to be my end. Cut down by God. One of the saddest verses in the Bible. Let me close with this. One of the saddest verses in the Bible is John 15:6. Talking about how we are a branch. And Jesus is the true vine. He said, if a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. Someday, friend, there will be a day of reckoning. Someday we will either be gathered unto God and spend eternity with him, or we will be cast into hell. Hell goes in, hell and death are cast into the lake of fire, and we suffer forever and ever and ever. I can't even wrap my mind around that. Last night when I was in bed, let me ramble just a minute or two more. Last night when I was in bed, I couldn't sleep because I was thinking about how the beginning, before there was the beginning, there was a beginning before the beginning. Before there was a beginning, there was a beginning before the beginning. If there to be a beginning, there had to be a beginner. And the beginner has always been. My. I didn't sleep real good. That's what I was thinking about. Because I look around me and I see the world that we live in. And And I know in my mind, friend, that didn't just come together. You know, nothing doesn't come from nothing. This world would have us to believe the lie of this world. Think about how many people believe this, that nothing plus nothing created everything. Even if you believe in the scientific theology, all that is religion, by the way. But even if you believe what the scientists tell you, where they say, oh, this cosmic dust and all the... Where'd the cosmic dust come from? Where do you get that? Where does it all begin? It all begins with God. I can understand how people of different faiths don't believe in Jesus Christ. I truly cannot understand how a thinking man or woman cannot believe that there's a God. There is a God, friend. He loves you. He gave Jesus Christ to die for you. He will do everything he can to plant you, to salvage you, to dig and dung in our life so that we do not have to be removed. But ultimately, my life and your life must produce fruit. If you are cut down today and your life doesn't bear fruit, think about where you will be forever. Ricky, would you play something for us? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I come to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Oh, Lord, if there's anybody here, if there's anyone in this service this morning that is not right with you, that doesn't know you, if there's anybody here this morning and you know, Lord, you know if their life was taken today that they would be separated from you for all of eternity. Lord, please, please bring conviction. Lord, we know we cannot save ourselves. It takes the convicting power of God, the Holy Spirit. If there's anyone here, Lord, I just ask you to bring that conviction. Send them, Lord, to the front of this church and to an altar to give their life unto you. We praise you, Lord. Oh, if there's anyone here this morning, and you say today, I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. Or I want to serve Him. I want to produce fruit because I want to spend eternity in heaven. If that's you this morning, I'm not going to prolong the service, and I'm sure not going to beg or try to coerce someone to come down. If you're here this morning and you say, I'm not right with God, and I need Jesus in my life, friend, please come down. God is saying, if you know what? You're still here this morning. You're not dead. You've been given more time. I don't know how much more time you have. I don't know how much more time I have. I don't know how much more time this world has. But this morning, you've been given a little more time. And God does not want to cut you down. If you're here and you say, today I want to give my life to Jesus Christ, I want you to walk down, make a public profession of faith, and say, today I'm not playing games any longer. I'm making Jesus the Lord of my life.